Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another exciting Propagandacast with me, your host, Imperial Dane, Master of Propaganda, here to deliver unto your ears and eyes more lovely company of heroes, footage, and commentary. Yes, indeed, I know you're all excited, brimming with glee, delightfulness, as you should be, and of course we'll be having a 1v1 today. Yes, indeed, a 1v1. No, that makes no sense. Nonetheless, we shall be seeing a fight on the Angoville. Yes, indeed, the plains of Angoville. We shall be seeing two forces clash, as is rather the custom, you know. No hugging, only bayonets, guns. Well, no bayonets either. No physical contact as such, you know, lots of guns. So that, of course, is what we like to see. And, of course, we shall be fighting off against each other. Well, here we are having Malacaphonous. Malacaphonous. Yes, the evil persist telephone. Malacaphonous. Fighting for the Third Reich, leading the elements of the 91st Luftlande Division, and the fight against the fight fearful armies. And who shall, of course, be leading the armies? It shall be Stamps, or XX Stamps. The most insane stamp collector in the entire US Army, enraged by the fact that he was conscripted into the US Army, or at least he was left with little choice, and so was driven away from his true quest of collecting stamps, and now seeks to deliver righteous retribution unto the German armies for that affront to his stamp collecting, fighting for the 4th Infantry Division. Yes, indeed. And let us get right down to it. Let us see how it shall go. Angry stamp collector versus the possessed telephone, the malevolent Malacaphonous. Pioneers on the way. Nothing highly unusual there. The third pioneer team. Now, this is where things are getting slightly more peculiar. What sort of strategy will we be seeing here? What sort of devious things have his Wehrmacht mind cooked up? Nothing this sort of here. In fact, we're seeing a barracks right close to the headquarters. It's sort of the thing more novice players do for. I mean, more experienced players have a tendency of placing it closer to the edge of the base of this. It's quicker for troops to get out from there on in. And of course, it also has the second advantage of then, of course, you have a spot to reinforce your troops from, which is not your headquarters, which in some cases tends to be the favorite spot to deliver artillery of unlimited quality. So, of course, placing it right there is not a bad idea, but of course, this rather means, of course, the Wehrmacht will be able to seize a lot more territory right off the bat. Americans focusing rather heavily on the east. Wehrmacht commander flinging a bit of, you know, manpower due to the fact that he was rather late in getting his Wehrmacht quarters up. Of course, question is what sort of unit will be going off. Oh, Stamps wishing his opponent good luck, have fun. Clearly not meant, as he's rather eager to get his vengeance. And no units are so far from Malacaphonous. Malacaphonous, who's getting a sniper. This is more unusual. Yes, I know we had the Monday novice fight yesterday, but still, in the longer run, this game actually gets a bit interesting. I mean, he actually ends up fighting better than a rank 16 Wehrmacht player, of whom I shall not mention, right from the auto in the east. In fact, we're seeing a pretty heavy, you know, effort in the east. The Wehrmacht focusing on pioneers. In fact, one pioneer team going heavily straight for the fuel points, while the third team sort of catches up. Of course, these pioneers might soon run into a problem. And we are seeing barbed wire going up here. And I imagine he's sort of trying to create some sort of wall so you can't easily get to the fuel point. Actually, had to run around, perhaps into some waiting riflemen, and pioneers are forced away from the east as the riflemen of Stamps out of the 4th Infantry Division push forwards, forcing away the pioneers of the 91st Luftlande Division, who are so far getting a sharpshooter and now an MG-42. So far, no infantry. Of course, they do have a slightly increased presence of pioneers, so of course they can seize territories, but again, the sort of direct fighting is what they will be casually lacking in. Further Americans flooding towards the east. This is absolutely, well, nothing particularly interesting so far. I mean, this is rather how things tend to go, you know. Americans go heavily towards the east because that's where they can have a much easier time on creeping up, seizing points, and of course there are things that rather support their efforts in such matters. The west is more Wehrmacht's friendly territory, much more open, and such, and sniper seems incredibly bold, running ahead of his friends, of his comrades, of any sort of safety lines. Completely uncloaked. Clearly this is a very courageous sniper. The little sniper that could. But how much could he do? And how soon would he get up with a bullet in his face? And has to be careful right there. Oh dear. And he's getting shot up. Oh dear, oh dear. Cloak, and there we go. MG42 sending up to protect the sniper. And Rifleman right out in the middle of the road, getting shot up, gunned down by the MG42. Sniper making a run for it, choosing the wrong path, running the gauntlet in the middle of the road. But no, the MG42 scares away the Rifleman. Too much heavy machine gun fire, the bark of the MG42 and the bite being too much. Volkskrieg is ready of the 91st Luftlande Division. The 91st being a... well, not exactly high-quality division. It was an infantry division made... basically it was an air gliding division, which was then converted into a regular infantry division, but never really sort of changed in name and basically puts onto Normandy to guard these areas. I mean, most of the troops, you know, holding the lines in Normandy, you know, the coastal defense, weren't exactly the crack SS forces. They were rather third or second-rate units. In some cases mixed up with reserve battalions, converted gear and, well, Russian troops which were pressed into the thing, you know, called the Ostbataillon. Attempted covering here, but of course the Americans ignore that. A rather large sweep around sniper gets discovered by the engineers. I mean, Malacaphonous, being an evil telephone, clearly hasn't quite understood the concept of a sniper, but you know, there we go. And Pioneer is trying perhaps to lure in the rifleman to the MG42. Of course, the MG42 needs to point in the bloody right direction, you know. The right direction, not the wrong one. Mines being laid down here to protect this area. MG42, again, not doing too well. Points in never the quite right direction. Rifleman getting ready for a push here. Volkskrieg is moving about, seizing territory, but they might soon get charged by the evil of the rifleman. So far, we are in fact seeing four teams, which is rather the standard. Volkskrieg is getting into the building. But there's absolutely nothing to support them. Another MG42 on the way. Still not a lot of infantry for Malacaphonous. And the MG42 getting charged. Rifleman going at it from one angle. The MG42, rather realizing it is in a bit of trouble, pulls away, runs away for dear life. Volkskrieg is holding out here against the troops out in the open. Doing all right despite not being the best position for it. And engineer team in fact goes down, shaft shoots, and there we go. The rifle also being forced away by the ever nasty sniper Volkskrieg near combo. In the meanwhile, the rifle are securing these, and these two pioneers are apparently completely forgotten by either side. Apparently they've sort of just forgotten it. Oh right, there might be some pioneers there, but who likes pioneers? I certainly don't. And then Malacaphonous goes, me too, which is a bit odd. No attempt at getting some skirmish facing or anything. In fact, he's going straight for another Volkskrieg team, and he's going rather extremely heavy for tier 1, and he's like making a slight mistake, you know. He's not really accounting for the fact that perhaps, you know, his opponent hasn't gone for Browning automatic rifles. That's sort of the thing you have to remember. But still, otherwise, reasonably nice handling of units. And certainly our friend here knows when to retreat. And there we go. Nicely placed mine. Rifleman nicely pinned, nicely wounded, though not nicely dead. Volkskrieg isn't moving about here. Will they be getting these riflemen? With the sniper? No, he's just running towards the west. MG42 covering. No, it's not set up. Two MG42s not set up, moving about with nothing to lead the way. That's not how you want to be using MG42s. Not at all. Pioneers getting gunned up. Need to retreat. No, they weren't retreated. Sniper opening up. Volkskrieg is hiding here. Rifleman slightly retreating. And Rifleman getting shot up by the MG42. Another one moving about here and there. Motorpool going up for stamps. The angry stamp collector. Rifleman getting shot up, sniped up, killed up. MG42 getting charged. Will the sniper be able to protect it? No, the MG42 might go down. Retreat, oh Malacaphonous. Retreat, oh evil possessed telephone, and save your troops. And there we go, Rifleman are forced away. Nice little engagement there, though, still forgetting his pioneers. Now with flamethrowers, I mean, so he can't be completely forgotten about them, but, you know, there we go. About bloody damn time, you stupid telephone. And Volkskrieg is still hiding in there. Might want to get them out and begin seizing territory again, you know, push onwards, onwards, and get some skirmish phase up. I mean, we are seeing a motor pool up, something's nasty going, it's bound to come out of that. And Malacaphonous needs, you know, skirmish phase and pack for it again. Rule of thumb, if you're not seeing a Browning automatic rifle after a certain amount of time, there's nothing specific because it can be dependent on sort of, you know, a lot of things, but generally, go for the PAP 38 always. And if you see a BAR, switch away. Perhaps get another MG42. Perhaps get a sniper. Perhaps get a grenadier if you have the Krieg barracks up. Something along those lines. And there we go. Krieg barracks is going up for Malacaphonous. Pioneers moving about. MP40 is being equipped for these false guns. MG42 taking up position here. Rifle pushing towards the west. Others reinforcing, and there we go. M8 armored car. Greyhound ready. Dashing through the French countryside. Blood is in the air as far as it's concerned. And these pioneers are under fire. Will Stamps be smelling their trap? Will he be smelling mines? The Greyhound advances. No armored skirts as so far. Pioneers need to run away. Run away. There we go. And this MG42 needs to stop advancing again. You know, it's a support. You need to keep it behind something to support. Sniper also making a run for it. Pack 38 is on the way. Perhaps, you know, a trick here is, of course, if you are a bit unsure, of course, you might get rushed. You know, place a mine right in front of the Krieg barracks. Thus, if they try the sort of M8 mine rush, or rush generally, you see, then when they try to place a mine right in front of the Krieg barracks, and that is something they like to do, he's going to hit a mine and find himself suddenly disabled himself. So very important that, but apparently Stamps is not pushing on with his Greyhound. He's not trying to push an advantage as such. Volkswagen is going down though. MG42 opening up on the riflemen, suppressing them, caught outside the house. The MG42 gives them the word of their Wehrmacht, telling them to sort off. Rest of the force is sort of hunting, might want to get them moving. Kampfkraft center going up, going to deliver Malacaphonous Kampfkraft to the Wehrmacht troops. M8 moving towards these pack for 38 moving towards the west. Less than ideal. And here we go. Stamps laying down a Greyhound mine to replace the one the Wehrmacht laid down. Sneaky, sneaky. In fact, it's time to have a look at Stamps. Opening up on the MG42. MG42 isn't what you might call trouble, you know. Not quite able to really harm the mighty M8. And MG42 out in the open. This is not what you'd call the best position. I mean, if you have to do it, and for example, have pioneers up, put down some sandbags. Otherwise, an MG42 can quickly go down if you're not careful. Sniper moving about. 8 kills so far. Volkswagen advancing. And the M8 getting panzerfausted. Panzerfausted again, apparently, has better things to do. And MG42 lost. Should have retreated much faster, much sooner. Certainly didn't help that the only door was right there in front of the M8. That tends to be less than good. And now Mr. Stamps is getting the Browning automatic rifle. Yes, indeed, a World War I era weapon. Sort of like an assault rifle, though it's more like an LMG. And partially also something called a battle rifle. Basically something you could sort of walk with and shoot as you advanced to keep your opponent's heads down. Bit of manpower being floated here. Could be used for more rifle. Could be used for a medic station. Could be used for a lot of things. Malacaphonous so far holding half the map, half the victory points, half the glory. M8 getting repaired after getting hit twice by Panzerfausts. Kampfkraft center is up. Something coming out of the Krieg barracks. And rifle getting sniped. Volkswagen is, you know, a bit of sandbags there could help, you know, when you're trying to take an aiming point. MG42 is not ready. Oh dear. M8 advances on the sniper. Oh dear. Sharpshooter to get away, and sniper is down. This was less than spectacular. Stamps could push through here. There's absolutely no mines, which is a bit to the discredit of Malacaphonous. But still, and there we go. Stamps pushing forwards. That is a good American. Except there's no good American, except a dead American. Grenadiers are ready but not moving about. Pack 38 was not ready to support, but the mines are going down. Not really looking spectacular for the Wehrmacht. 2 grenadier teams now. Well, let's speed this up as Malacaphonous gets his act together. He seems to be a bit unsure what to do. Grenadiers on the move. Grenadiere advancing for the Fatherland. Pantrix equipped. At least one is. Rifleman team number 1 retreats. Grenadiers then pull back. Come on, Malacaphonous. Move on, move on. Looks like he is pushing hard for the east. MG42 taking up position in the house. Volkswagen is out in the open versus men with automatic weapons again. And the rifle, in fact, run away. Quite intriguing. Grenadiers advancing through the west. Apparently, the Greyhound mine did go off earlier. So the Grenadiers have nothing to worry about. Question is, who did have to worry about it, since someone had to set it off? and dual Panzerjacks now, of course, one on each team. That is a good split. I've been getting gunned up, taking quite severe losses. And the Pack 38 hits the M8. Oh dear, Panzerjacks could knock it out. Panzerjack from the Panzer Schreckers. And there we go, the Schreck of Panzers knocked into the rear of the Greyhound. Limping away. Engine on fire. And will the Panzerjacks hit one final time? No, the main gun. Oh wait, there we go, out of control. Enter the strategic point. And an anti-tank gun blasts away at the Grenadiers. That was certainly a nice move. Engineers forced away. Might want to be a bit more aggressive here. You know, beginners using points through here and here. Sniper could also be moving forwards a bit. Grenadiers advance a bit too close to the base. Trying to knock out that anti-tank gun. But a Vickers machine gun... Not a Vickers. That's a regular machine gun emplacement. With a 30 caliber Browning opening up. Forcing away those Grenadiers. Leaving behind only one team at the front. That was slightly less great decision. But Malacaphonous certainly could do with a bit more. And another M8 to replace the one lost in the Panzerjack fire. Grenadiers pulling back, but they are simply outmanned and outgunned. Neat retreat, there we go. Oh dear, only one man left, and he barely makes it out of there alive. False Grenadiers might push a bit more, you know, link up actions, for example, you know. Use the tactical map, choose a unit, and then sort of, you know, hold shift down and click about points. Sniper opening up on the riflemen. Pioneers exposed. There's absolutely nothing here. The sniper, in fact, could be hunted down. No, he retreats. But these pioneers need to retreat as well, you know. More grenadiers from Malacaphonous. Apparently, he's going back for the sort of good old-fashioned grenadier spam. Lovely spam. No, it's not. Greyhound number two ready. And grenades ready for stamps, yes indeed. But Malacaphonous need to sort of learn getting, you know, a bit more action into his troops, a bit more fire, a bit more bloody movement instead of, you know, hanging about with his force in his space less than, you know, spectacular. Rather than moving about here. And of course this is rather why this house is nasty, because, you know, stand right here. So then of course a grenade or two over the hedge. And well, in this case only one goes down, but still this is looking less than happy. False Grenadiers caught on their own. They need to retreat. Run away. Veterancy too though, but still run away. Flamethrowers even. Run away. I repeat myself. Run away. And there we go. Only one man makes it out of there alive. The other three go down. And these Grenadiers again need to move. And he needs to be careful about, you know, clamping up like that. Not helpful at all. But there we go. It's the advance of the Grenadier. Sniper opening up. Rifleman getting shot up. Pick up truck, which they tried to hide behind, getting blasted a bit by Panzerjacks. And the advance of the Veteran C2 Grenadiers, quite protected against BAR fire due to their metals and burly Grenadier chests. Apparently gained for Veteran C2, they are able to absorb more fire, though in reality it's just to sort of reflect that they are better at taking cover. But you know, it's more of a general thing rather than, you know, based on if they're actually in cover. And the game can do that because I believe it's the mortar which actually has a bonus which says it only takes this and this much damage, you know, when in cover. Penny's getting another MG42, but still might want to, you know, push the advantage, perhaps get some armored cars. And of course he wants to split out his troops. He wants to seize as much territory as possible. He wants to advance. He wants to kill some armies. And an observation post right there. Not there. And the Greyhound marches out. Pack 38 is not really there to support its troops. MG42 and Pioneers moving forwards. Grenadiers under heavy fire might want to take cover, you know, cover, or at least they want to render this point neutral, thus cutting off the fuel. Come on, Grenadiers, cover, you stupid. And there we go, running away. Pack 38 actually moving up and uncloaks it. Good move. He seems to be a bit unsure, you know, when to coordinate actions. And looks like a half track is on the way with the quad mount on the way as well. MG42 covering this area, but this seems a bit pointless. A mortar would be better in that case. And Volksgren is moving towards the west. Rather heavy push by the 91st in the west. Reifman advancing. Panzerjack troops equipping. And we're also seeing an observation post there. Stamps really liking his fuel. Really liking his munitions. Of course, they're currently cut off and lost. And the M8 under fire from the Pack 38. Rifleman though advancing on the Pack 38, and there's absolutely nothing to cover it. The MG42 cannot. Oh wait, there we go, advancing, sending up to cover the Pack 38. The Panzer up there, Kanone 83. actually not the primary anti-tank gun of the Wehrmacht by this part of the war. That was actually the Pak 40, which about had the same gun as, which had the exact same gun as the Marder 4-3. That was actually the gun it used. The Pak 38 was more the premier weapon of, you know, 1941, 1942, until the Pak 40 could be produced in sufficiently large numbers. So of course, like little detail there, and the Pak 40 being one of the few anti-tank guns of the larger kind, which could sort of reasonably be pushed around by infantry. Beyond that, stuff like, for example, the 17-pounder actually needed some sort of tractor or the vehicle to actually move it about. Otherwise, we'll quickly get into trouble. Supply lines are broken. We have territory out of supply. So slight detail there. Mobility is, of course, important. And fun fact about American tank destroyer doctrine, they actually didn't rely really on, you know, actual tank destroyers. They mostly relied on anti-tank guns. And, of course, that turned out a bit rubbish, since anti-tank guns aren't really that mobile and that great on the offensive. Krautmauer. Ever so pleasant. Volksgrenadiers standing by, ready. Yeah. Grenadiers moving forward against the M8, getting a Pantrick off at it. The Pak 38, though, has been cleared out and not recruited. Looks like he's making ready for an assault in the east now, not trying to finish the job in the west. That seems to be a bit of a nasty habit. No Panzerfaust at the half-track. Grenadiers out in the open, have to be careful against that Quad mount, and there we go. Pandrick hits the quad mount, though, gets away. And no attempt at really pushing through here, but perhaps, you know, occupied in the west. Might want, you know, push forwards. Forwardsmänner. A bit of barbed wire here. In fact, by stamps, that's actually a clever move, you know, using barbed wire to clear off, close off these areas. Sadly, there's no further that one in mind, you know. And Grenadiers forced away, rifle pushing forwards. In the name of Uncle Sam, and I do believe it's time to have a look at Malacaphonous again, and I do believe it's time for the mid-game analysis. Yes, indeed, 20 minutes into the game, in fact, a bit more than that. I might have been a bit late on my mark, but there we go still. And currently, the Wehrmacht, you know, not doing too well in the 91st Luftlande Division, had some problem, you know, in lacking in aggression, being a bit too passive, standing about with too many troops in the base, and of course, a bit too many support units in the start, although he has recovered with several Grenadier teams and some Volksgrenadiers, so this is good. In fact, he's getting veterancy free. He's really hoping, you know, incredibly tough Grenadiers can win him the fight. And trouble is, while they're certainly tough, they're not going to win you a fight against a clever opponent, one who knows his stuff. But still, I mean, that's also one of the reasons I wanted to show this is, you know, more than just a Monday novice fight. I mean, it's actually going to show you some, you know, how you fight, you know, veterancy free Grenadiers. It's not a high level play, but still, you know, how perhaps a more regular player, you know, might handle stuff like this. So, of course, I hope you learned something through it. Of course, these rifles and all that, but they haven't really gained a lot of veterancy, which is certainly good for the Wehrmacht commander, since Americans, as they get more veterancy, get tougher and get more lethal. No supplied upgrades. And, of course, he does have grenades. Of course, thing is, he does have the vehicles, but trouble is the Pantricks and mass make it a bit harder, plus that Pak 30, at least in the west, makes it also harder. The only thing so far working for stamps is, of course, the lack of activity from Malacaphonous, the possessed telephone. On the other hand, Malacaphonous might want to consider getting something, perhaps, you know, a bit more armored, perhaps some Stuk, perhaps some armored cars, which were sort of more an armored car than a tank, or perhaps, you know, going straight for the Panzer Command and getting some bloody Panzers. But still, there you go, some thoughts. No doctrine as of yet either. But let us return to the fight. Either side getting the armor first would certainly have the advantage. I mean, a Sherman would really tear through those Grenadiers. And we are in fact seeing a Sturm Armory going up for Malacaphonous, just as I casually mentioned it. Yes, indeed. I'm a genius. And Grenadiers sending down these riflemen, riflemen pulling back Pioneers flame for support. No veterancy for them at all. That could actually help a bit. And Grenadiers and riflemen facing off. And grenades by the riflemen at the Grenadiers, but they... Oh dear, I know what Stamps was trying to do. He wasn't, you know, being, you know, sort of silly. No, he was, you know, trying to protect that the Grenadiers would charge at him. But trouble here, and of course that's a clever thing, and let's just briefly pause again for that, you know. Malacaphonous wasn't moving. He realized troops are more accurate when they're standing still. You don't want to be charging at automatic weapons either, so what do you do? Well, I have rifles. They're great at range. Grenadiers are great at range. I just stand still, get more accurate, and then can do terrible things to the riflemen. Of course, there was an attempt to sort of suppress a fire, but that was too late. And of course, the Grenadiers fell much too short because he was anticipating him to charge at him. Not a bad idea, but again, Malacaphonous sort of predicted that and sort of went, well, I'll just stand here and fire even more accurately. Sucks to be you, mate. So good move there by Malacaphonous. Nice attempt by here by Stamps XX to sort of, you know, predict it. It just was the wrong sort of prediction. It happens from time to time. Happens even for the best. Rifle standing about here. No real effort in infantry in the west, though. Not looking good. Of course, false grenades and grenades could be pulled together. Floating a bit of manpower again. You want to be careful about that, though. He's not going into the complete crazy zone of bloody hell. He's floating 2,000 manpower, which I actually think I have seen once. And I certainly have seen one game where the one was closing, floating close to 1,000 munitions, which was also today. In fact, he's getting an LMG 42 for these grenadiers. That will be interesting. That will be very interesting indeed. Yes, Commander. Raffin sneaking through here, of course, avoiding this Schwerpunkt of Wehrmacht with the sniper, the PAK-38, and the MG-42. Clever thought, you know, I mean, keeping an idea of, well, where's my opponent probably going to have his positions in, and how will he be placed? I'll just move about that and be a sneaky little bastard. Grenadiers advancing with the MG-42 with Panzerfrick. False grenades moving in. Sturm Armory is up. Probably on land from some other unit. Could be from a Stuk Abteilung. Or Stuk Brigade, oh dear, I can't entirely remember. Stuks, besides being handed out to Panzer divisions, and in some cases Panzer Grenadier divisions, which make up for lack of Panzers, were also on a more independent battalion basis. Grenadiers facing off here against this Rifleman. No grenades getting locked at them, still no doctrine. MG-42 coming from the house. Malacaphonous really getting the suppression off from these rifles and grenades. My goodness, a garage collapses at complete awe, causes it to collapse. Half track advances, opening up on the building. MG-42 keeps firing. BAR picked up by the grenadiers. No, they don't pick it up, you sorry lot. And then get moving at that half track advancing. Ooh, it could sneak in. Oh dear, it catches the sniper. The anti-aircraft gun turned out to be also an anti-sniper gun. Now opening up on the MD4. Oh, running in right in front of the PAK-38. Oh dear, oh dear. These troops need to move in to support the PAK-38. PAK-38 turning about. Half-track trying to move about again. Grenadiers moving in to support. No, they're not. And there we go. Southern troops moving in to deal with it. Still floating an awful lot of manpower. Use it. Use it, Malacaphonous. Please. Promise me to use it. And MD42 opening up. MD42 opening up. Panzerfrick flying but missing. Grenadiers need to be moving, and again, use your damn resources, Malacaphonous, please. You would make me so happy, or at least less sad. And of course, one thing to remember, stand still when you're using the LMG, and there we go, opening up. Rifleman taking quite a bit of damage. Grenade getting lobbed at the Rifleman. Grenade lobbed at the Grenadiers, no, at the false Grenadiers. Half-tack opening up. Grenadiers surviving partially. Panzerfrick killing one Rifleman. This is absolute carnage. And the M8 moves in. Absolutely moves in, gunning down a few grenadiers. False grenadiers need to get away, retreat. Rückzug, Rückzug, Dummkopf. And there we go. And oh, they didn't make it, and the PAK-38 wasn't turned about. Oh dear. And still, oh wait, there we go. Sturmgeschütz on the way from an independent Sturmgeschütz Abteilung. Which of course one of the things that Wehrmacht sort of had a tendency of also creating sort of more units that was independent and could easily be attached to different units as were sort of needed. Sturmgeschütz for assault guns was one of those. Tank destroyers in some parts were also. Well, that was later on with the Hetzers and the Jagdpanzer Force, really, when that came around. Tigers were also one, and then sort of particular sort of assault. Well, here's the trick. Well, assault tanks, I suppose, would be the thing. I mean, it's rather, you know, the tricky bit when they had sort of things that were sort of close up each other. One of those were the Sturmpanzer and the Sturmgeschütz. The Sturmpanzer being basically some very, very armored, close support artillery of a sort, meant to blow up buildings, really, you know, urban. Oh dear, these grenadiers are simply getting gunned up, and there we go. I mean, lots of rifle. Oh dear, I mean, grenadiers out in the open, even with that veterancy, it's not going to do well. PAK-38 outflanked. Oh dear, Malacaphonous. For being an evil telephone, you're not too clever. And there goes Sturmgeschütz moving in. MG42 cleared up. PAK-38 cleared up. This is absolute madness. Still no doctrine. Sturmgeschütz and floating so much manpower. Opening up on the half track, which is gained veterans 1, getting increased speed. And oh dear, Malacaphonous, you're moving straight into a den of infantry. The only thing saving you is the fact that he doesn't have sticky bombs. Malacaphonous, do not ever, ever count on that. And mate moving in against the MG42. Pioneer sort of standing about here, not looking too good. MG42 needs to get away. Sturmgeschütz actually pulling away slightly. Grenadiers need to save this situation. Apparently ignoring the infantry, going for the M8. But again, train units getting another Stuka, but get some infantry, get some replacement stuff up. Grenadiers advancing. And again, remember, stand still with the MG42 if you want it to be effective. It's a support unit for your other infantry. Grenade getting lopped. Now we got right into the mix of it. Oh dear, heavy losses for Stamps. His stamp collecting infantry dying, and the Pack 38 cleared out. The crew slaughtered. Sturmgeschütz hunting down the M8 armored car. And fun fact about the Stug, it was also used as a tank destroyer. It was, of course, good at that, but you know, it wasn't its main purpose. Manual that was handed out, Stug commanders actually pointed out, you stupid bastards, don't use it exclusively as a tank destroyer. There's other stuff to handle that. But still, they were used, of course, in those cases, you know, used it like that. But for assault gun units, it's an assault gun, not a tank destroyer. And the rather thing was, the Germans rather didn't like having a unit that was only rather specific at only doing one thing, like, you know, only destroying tanks. They rather wanted things that could do several things, like, you know, auto-kill infantry or positions. And thus the concept of the assault gun. And LMG-42 rifle getting... Get away, mates! Grenade getting lopped, get into cover, you know, a bit of sandbags again would have helped, but no! And then we're going to town through. Sturmgeschütz needs to move into support. No veterans here. Another Stug ready. There we go. Getting more grenadiers. Still not getting any sort of doctrine. I mean, he could have gotten your Blitzkrieg. Could have gotten Stu-42s. Could have gotten a lot of things. Stormtroopers. But sadly, no. Still, he's doing better than some of the armor players I've seen. Sturmgeschütz gets too close to the infantry. And there we go. Stamps no longer waiting about, double sticky bombing it. And fun fact about this, oh dear, he's staying about with his grenadiers, not trying to seize territory. I mean, he's moving into hostile territory, he knows this, in the infantry, and apparently he's just... Come on, Malacaphonous, you did alright. Please don't fall apart now. But Stamps is rather on the ball, charging forwards, getting ready, perhaps lobbing a few grenades. Although we haven't actually seen a lot of grenades from Stamps. There we go, nice hit by the Sturmgeschütz. Also, fun fact about the Sturmgeschütz, it can only take 3 sticky bombs. 3 sticky bombs and it's gone. And the Calliope opens up. Yes, indeed, we have seen a Calliope moving in. Fun fact about the Calliope, though, it wasn't actually available in Normandy. It later only come about at, you know, the Battle of the Bulge. And, oh dear, another Sturmgeschütz down. Oh dear, this was less than good. And now he's, in fact... Grenadiers retreating there. Now he's getting Blitzkrieg. Now he's getting the Stu-42. Now he's getting an armored car. And the M8 hoping to get a good off shot on that armored car. Pioneers moving through here. Malacaphonous really needs to work on his unit control, you know. I mean, I'm not going to say micromanagement is the sort of highest thing you need to know in the game. That's not his tactic and strategy, but you know, it's certainly something you might occasionally want to work on in these cases like these, where you know, have a lot of units standing about doing nothing, you know. The best I can check, you know, is suggest is perhaps, you know, try playing a campaign and try to complete the missions as swiftly as possible, you know. Don't, you know, have times where you're spending time, you know, collecting huge forces, just, you know, attack, attack, attack. Be aggressive as many points as possible. Stu-42 blasting away. No proper support, and that armored car needs to move in. These grenadiers also need to move in. And of course, armor doctrine allows your armored vehicle to access these points. 242 advances, need to be careful. Could we flank? No, the grenadiers protect the flank. 242 opens up. The M8 not built to survive that, but there's another anti-tank gun. Sniper, and fresh sniper is ready to protect. And the Calliope barrage a bit too close. Oh dear, the Stu-42. You don't move into that, you stupid bastard. Sniper almost dead, needs to retreat. Retreat, please. Panzerfaust needs to open up. Oh dear. Another Stu kill for that M8. Those chaps are certainly going to have something to brag about if they make it out of there alive. Now the grenadiers are getting assaulted by riflemen. Need to retreat. They don't have support. Adequate support, at least. And again, he's standing about with too much, you know, troops in his base. I mean, another trick would be to create control groups. So that way you can always basically say, alright, I need all my infantry, 1, 2, 3, or, you know, create a huge control group at least. And, you know, I don't want you to clump up, but at least it's, you know, and that's what I'm more called, you know, a march unit. You know, you're not grouping up to sort of attack in a clump, you're grouping them up so you can easily get one clump to the front line, and then you spread them up and doing something. I mean, the Wehrmacht had a sort of formation for that. It was called basically the March Battalion. Basically, they grouped up a lot of infantry. They weren't sort of, you know, meant to attack. They were basically just there to get you from one point to another. And the half-track force went all three victory points in the hands of the 4th Infantry Division. Not sure where the armored car came from, possibly on the lend from the 17th SS moving in to assess for the SS. Another armored car ready, apparently dropping the Stukes now. Having lost three, which is certainly less than spectacular. Armored car needs to be careful. All right handling there, but overall control, you know, overall management. Again, you know, push forwards, so there's a lot of territory, you know, forwards, men out. Hauruck, something like that, and the armored car comes under fire from an anti-tank gun, you know, you might want to flank, or no, pulling back, but again, you know, try at least to focus on these, you know, and this is where my Malacaphonous might have, you know, could have at least, you know, try and sort of focus, you know, sometimes, you know, you just want to hold one side of the map, at least until it can create a stable force, but no, sniper ready. He needs more Sturmgeschütz and he needs to take out those Calliopes. A second one has in fact arrived. The Calliope which wasn't actually Normandy has arrived with a second one in Normandy. The sort of, well, tank artillery they had, sort of, was a Sherman with a 105mm gun. It was a bit like the Stu 42, you know, it was sort of a unit to pull up and then blast anything that was, you know, looking naughty in the sight of the American army. Rather thoroughly, but there we go. I mean, about damn time, you know, he's putting down Sam Max, he's putting down Bart. Why, he's sort of remembering. Who knows, perhaps he even watches the propaganda cast. I wouldn't kid myself. And everybody does. And looks like most of his grenadiers, in fact, there. Taking up position there, and LMG might be firing lots of grenadiers, in fact blasting away of course, and there we go. Heavy Calliope barrage right at all of these clumped up grenadiers, it's a barrage of death, the grenadiers explode into multicolored blast of bits, oh dear. Again, you know, spread out, don't clump up all of your grenadier assets in one spot. And sadly that was pretty much two of his grenadier teams, gone in a flash. Well, several flashes of explosive power. Let's speed this up. I think there's not much left. Armored cars moving in. Oh, wait, there S apparently. I was a bit remembering wrong. Trying to sticky bomb. And of course, remember, Veterans E2 rifleman team can cast a sticky bomb or throw it much farther than a regular rifleman team. So, then again, that's something you have to be very careful about. You know, again, stay extra far away from those chaps. But they are forced away. Half-track apparently designed to move in. The M8, though, with Veterans E2 could prove a bit of a hazard. There we go. Armored cars under fire. Grenadiers getting ready again. Sadly, the LMG 42 was irrevocably lost. And point being taken again. We are winning this battle. Let us speed things up a bit for the Fatherland. Malacaphonous losing an armored car, hoping to perhaps clear out that anti-tank gun, and what is this? A tiger arriving. Malacaphonous petting his last hopes on a tiger, a mighty tiger, but he's not moving in his grenadiers to support it. That was less than great. Stormtroopers now advancing as well with Pantrix, and oh my god, great game. Stamps clearly enjoying, and so is Malacaphonous. That's always nice, you know, enjoy the game. Sticky bombs on the tiger though, less than good, less than good. And more sticky bombs. This tiger is clearly down for the count. And there we go. Game over. A victory for the 4th Infantry Division, the 91st Luftlande Division, despite support from the SS. And a Sturmgeschütz Abteilung, it did not make it. And of course, you know, this was more novice, but still, for, you know, had some vantage points. Flung quite a bit of manpower there. Stamps, you know, be careful. Manpower's not like stamps. They're not supposed to be collected. Nonetheless, what can we learn from here? I mean, you know, don't bunch up right there, and then the Calliope people are sure that, but you know, again, train yourself to, you know, a bit more aggressive, you know, always have troops on the go, and you know, try to lay down sandbags, barbed wire. That was rather the problem with the, you know, Malacaphonous. He rather had the advantage, he had time to play it down, but he didn't.
Otherwise, you know, Mines did an alright time, but they didn't really get featured again. That's sort of the thing with, you know, lower level games. But still, I mean, for low level players, they did alright. I mean, I've certainly seen high level players do worse. Good job with veterancy, although he might have waited with veterancy 3, gotten something else. Storm Gazette's handling, less than good, you know, don't charge up. And infantry, in particular, riflemen, otherwise you'll get sticky bombed. And again, remember, 3 sticky bombs can mean a dead stuk. And sure enough, he didn't get any armor veterancy either. No medic stations, no medic bunkers, I'm pretty sure no... Wait, that was a supply and upgrade, good job there. Stamps are still, you know, I can certainly think that Stamps has a sort of slightly bright future ahead of him if he keeps doing his best and, of course, keeps learning. He certainly, you know, didn't try to attack from the front, he sort of tried flanking. That certainly worked well. So there you go, hope you enjoyed it. If you did, why not subscribe, your tell your friends, and if you didn't, well, why not send in a replay of your own? This is Imperial Dane saying cheers.